This is Turbo TV UK.
Great Jesus. In the house of God is fullness of joy. It is the only place that you can express your feeling and your atmosphere, because there is some mountains, some deep richness in you, which every time it needs to come out. And sometimes we don't even know ourselves. You will be surprised to know what is inside you when that visits you one time and you ask yourself, I didn't know that I can do this, but they are there. There is some deep, the depth side of you, because we don't get the only one dimension. We live in three dimensions in Christ, and that is a different level of another world that make the Christian be unique and different from all other people. And that makes us these special people in the society where we live. Hallelujah. Praise Him. Hallelujah. Mighty God, we give God a praise. We give God a praise. Please, last week we've been talking about some series during the whole of the 3 weeks continuously, and still we have to carry on, because this is where we want to let every believer to understand the point of where we stand. If you are a Christian, what I wanted to pull your knowledge and your understanding and your thoughts about is that to see every situation in life, every problem you are going through, every battle that you are going through, to see that in the light of the scriptures. If you cannot spell your name in the scriptures, if you cannot spell your name in the scriptures, you cannot also spell your problems in the scriptures. So once we can see we are called Christian, and we are made with the word, we are made with the power, we are made with the spirit, born of the spirit and of the water, then we can also express the same definition to our problems in the scriptures. A Christian who don't see the value of the scriptures, how to attack problems of life in the light of the scriptures which have been given to us where we were born from, then you will go through a lot of situations where you become a miserable Christian. Hallelujah. So we have been going through a series which is challenging us how we can understand how to deal with situations, problems, the strongholds of society in the light of the gospel which have been given to us. And it is the gospel which is the only word that God has given to us, the only message that God has given to us, which is the power of God unto salvation. So if you want to come out and become free, if you want to be set free from demonic oppression, if you want to be set free from all kinds of situations and strongholds in society, except you go back and retrieve this power, the message that God has given to us, then we can see ourselves. We are not able to define who we are. We don't understand what is going on with us. We get frustrated, and sometimes we are deceived by lies, plausible lies that make it look like we are all right. So many Christians are living their life thinking that they are Christians, they are born again, but they don't check themselves, they don't see to it that the way a born again believer is supposed to live is a different dimension. And so we fall short and be deceived by the things of the world, be deceived by all kinds of worldly weapons. The worldly weapons are some weapons which the world has formulated, and by formulating these weapons, they don't fit in what we are doing. They don't fit where we come from. And we too have been given the weapon. So the Bible talked to us about this weapon, which we know and have been dealt with. That with these weapons were mentioned, which even in Ephesians chapter 6, we are told to put on that armor of God. The whole armor of God. And this whole armor is what we call the weapons that have been given to you and I, to destroy the strongholds, to deliver ourselves from the plausible arguments to sort ourselves out and also set society free. So we have been given assignment with the weapons to carry with us. But how do we see this weapon? This weapon, which we name it, last 2 weeks we talked about them, they are the weapons of truth, the weapons of love, the weapons of righteousness, and the weapon of faith prayer. Now we will not see these weapons in any other place except this weapon be seen in the gospel of Jesus Christ. So without we proclaiming and demonstrating the gospel of Jesus Christ, we will not be able to unlock our weapon. And as such, all our spiritual, eternal blessings are in check. The devil will torture us with the blessings that God has given to us. Praise Jesus. So we have been looking through the scriptures in the light of all this truth. In the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 10, which I want you to open your Bible with me today as well. We have to be very careful and take it very slowly from that place, because there is a lot over there for us to carry. Not to just run through the scriptures, but let the scriptures run through us, so that the scripture will begin to digress the powerful weapon which God has given to you and I to deploy every situation in society. Now today we would like to look through verse chapter 10 from verse 4 and 5. Hallelujah. Chapter 10 from verse 4 and 5, 2 Corinthians. The Bible says, "For the weapons of our warfare are not worldly, but have divine power to destroy strongholds. We destroy arguments and every proud obstacle to the knowledge of God, and take every thought captive to obey Christ. For the weapons of our warfare are not worldly." Some of your Bible put it in a different way, but they all the same meaning. "For the weapons of our warfare are not worldly, but have divine power to destroy strongholds. We destroy arguments and every proud obstacle to the knowledge of God, and take every thought captive to obey Christ." Last week we discussed about the secret of the strength of this stronghold. When we mention about strongholds, we are talking about situations and problems which are not easier to dislocate. They are not easier to take them away from our life. They are in the society, but without everything, all the problems of the world have tried everything, but they cannot be able to take them off. And this is also affecting we the Christians as well in where we live, either individually or society level. So these are called strongholds. It is a situation where evil is entrenched, tortured you, and whatever you try, you can't take them out. And they are living with us. They go with us. They come with us. And we see other people suffering with the same problems in the world. Now, this is a passage where the Spirit of God is referring that we can see through to it and come out of how we can understand the problems that are going on in our world and how to deploy them with the weapons that have been given to us. So he said, "For the weapons of our warfare are not worldly, but have divine power to destroy strongholds. We destroy arguments and every proud obstacle to the knowledge of God, and take every thought captive to obey Christ." I want you to look through this passage and digress yourself. What do you understand by that? Praise Him. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this powerful word which you have laid in front of us this morning. Father, I know many of us sitting down here have come up with difficulties and problems the fundamental questions to come and ask you, Lord, to deliver us and to set us free. There are a lot of bondage around us. Wherever we go, wherever we come, in our news, in everywhere we pass, the stronghold of society is everywhere full, attacking us. Lord, we have come to seek answers from you, and you have given us a weapon. Father, speak to us and touch us that we will go home. Begin from today, from now, to walk in the newness of the understanding of the weapons that have been given to us, to deploy either individually and socially around us every stronghold that have captured your people. Because we stand in the position where you chose us and you gave us the power and you called us and said that we are your church and the gate of hell will not prevail against us. So you form us as a stone, a solid stone that you have built us to bring us to deliver life of people. That means, Lord, you are working through us. Do your work through us and bring your plans through us. We stand in front of you, mighty God. We don't prove to be anything, but we don't prove to be something, but we prove to be nothing except you who have begun a good work in us. Take it control and finish with us. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hallelujah. He said, for the weapons of our warfare are not worldly. I want you to look through this passage very well with me because I want to speak to your hearing. I want to talk to your spiritual understanding because there are some areas of you which you have never known. There are some depth of you which you have not understood those areas of your life properly. And it is through this passage, it is through these teachings that will enlighten you if you are going to be a better Christian or a poor Christian. There are many miserable Christians who don't understand what the Christian faith is all about. And the Bible said in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 19, it said, if your hope in Christ Jesus is of this world only, you are of all men most miserable Christian. So we must look through things and understand the way things are operate in the light of the scriptures so that we can walk in them and conquer them with victorious power which the Lord has given to us in Christ. God has spoken to us in these last days in His Son. And that is the message that you and I carry. So the Bible says that these are our weapons. I don't know what God spoke to you. I don't know what you hear from God. I don't know what you understand of your own weapons, how you fight the battles of life. But I've come to tell you that there's only one way that the power of God lies in that weapon for you. And that weapon destroys stronghold. The word of the Lord says that the weapons of our warfare are not worldly. They are nowhere to be found except in heaven. And you and I know the truth about the word that we are to set our mind on things and our affections on things above. Because why? We belong above. Our life is hidden in Christ Jesus, sitting on the right hand side of the Father. And so when it comes to about our living in this society, our living in the world, we got no answer to stand or declare anything about our own. Except the Lord who called us. So he said, the weapons of our warfare are not worldly. If you are seeking any things of the world, please, I beg your pardon. There's nothing wrong with that. But you don't put your trust, your faith, your love in the things of the world, especially concerning about dealing with the strongholds and problems of this world. Because the world is controlled with illusion, false illusion, lies. And these lies have built up a situation that challenges you and I, our faith. So we stand, whatever we do, we watch ourselves very carefully. The Bible says, be wise like a serpent. And so we walk humbly to understand what the Spirit of God is teaching us today, so that we can be very powerful in what we are doing. It doesn't matter how number we are here. It was the same with the disciples in the first century with these weapons, and they were able to deploy the strongholds around them. And so we too, it has reached us that we have now got a privilege calling ourselves Christians. God used other people to do the job. And so we too, we long to suffer, to go out there and let God use us to touch other lives who are under the hell, under the gate of hell, being in captivity. Have you ever realized yourself that living on this earth is not just you thinking that you are all right? We were all dead in sin. Despite the fact that you live, doesn't mean that you are not dead in spirit without Christ. We were dead in sin. The Bible makes it very clear to us that by one man's sin entered into the world of mankind, and the whole world of mankind died spiritually. So everything that we were living, it is on credit that the very time you finish served your probation, awaiting a death, waiting to bound you into captivity. But God has given us His word. The word of salvation is the power of God. That is the only word that can deliver you and I. And if that word that deliver you and I from the penalty of death, why can't the same power of that word sort out the problems or the strongholds which is the devil society and around us? When you open the news, you see everywhere around the world situations that are so powerful to take them out. Situations that you can't touch them. Situation where even the church is adopting them into the house of God. Situation that we can't even answer them by ourselves. Except that we look at them and walk backward and thinking that we can pocket ourselves and leave and wait for the Lord to come and take us with Him. But let's not forget that the life that we live is not us. It is Christ who lives inside us. And we are part of the plan of God. So we have been given an assignment to do. The assignment is that we have a power that is above the stronghold. We have a divine power that is stronger than the stronghold, the problems of society. I don't know your problem that you are going through. It may either be ancestral curse, it may either be sicknesses and disease, it may either be poverty, it may either be any social situation that you are going through, but I have a message for you. I have a message of hope. I have a message that is about what you are going through. I have a message of power. I have a message that sets you free from the shackles of the hands of any evildoer. I have a message that has come to protect your family. I have a message that has come to open your mind to understand things about every situation and guide your heart. Oh my God. I have a message for you. He said, you and I have got a right to destroy arguments and every proud obstacle to the knowledge of God. Now today, I would like to speak about the first part of this, because the second part says that we take every thought into captivity or captive to obey Christ. I would like to speak about the first part. We destroy arguments and every plough. The verse number 4 has introduced the weapon which we carry, so that we will not forget the weapon we carry. We carry the weapon of truth, the weapon of love, the weapon of righteousness, and the weapon of faith prayer. And he said, now this weapon, put them on, they are armor. Put them on and destroy every argument and every proud obstacle to the knowledge of God. Some of your Bible tells you that every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Now, is there anything in your life that you could see that it is not in line with the biblical principle that you struggle to take them out, yet you've done everything you can't? Is there any situation that you have tried and fight it, but anytime you make an attempt, it puts you down and stop you completely? In any situation, some questions and answers that you have been trying from since your childhood, trying to know the meaning and answer, yet you still stand behind the door and you cannot even answer to yourself. He said, "He has given to you the powerful divine power to destroy this stronghold, and we have to destroy argument." Now, what we see over here, which last week we discussed about, is that behind every problem, behind all the puzzles, the problem that puzzles and bedevils society and individuals, there is two things behind it. I mentioned that last week. And the two things is what the Bible is talking to you and I. They are what? Argument and pride. That is where all the strength of the problems which is going on in our society, the problem which are called stronghold. Now these problems get their source of energy from argument and pride. Without building argument and the pride behind that argument, there is no way anybody can bypass the mind which they use to do what they do. The reason to think that they are satisfied with what they are doing, so they now bypass the guilty conscience in them. But they build argument, and that argument, some circumstances started. Situations started. And that situation is illusion. It's a false illusion. It is a plausible lies. Plausible lies, it looks like it is very nice and very perfect. It looks like you are very okay with that. And you are satisfied living with it. Some will be the life and attitude and character of your children. Some will be in your marriage, your spouse. Some will be in your family. Some will be with any other people, your loved ones, and people you live around. You find it very difficult to even approach. They look like they are all right. And some of them, because of their intellectual advancement, whenever you try to go closer to them, the place they take you to, you can't even at all get closer to them. They have built a strong boundaries around it. They have built a castle around it. And that is what we call argument and pride. Argument and pride. And that is a human pride. These two things. Human pride, that is a pride as independent from God. There is a certain lie behind that. And that is what we call self-sufficient. Self-sufficient. Now, self-sufficient humanity is something that is not bad for somebody to do. But yet, God has created all of us to be a capable being. But not in ourselves. So nobody can ever have a self-sufficient humanity or independent from God. But there is a lie behind our life which the world is all built upon, that they will live without God. They will provide everything to themselves without God. Let us be very careful in this aspect of statement here, because some of them fall short or trick in our own personal characters and attitude. When it comes to our character in line with God, we find ourselves that there are certain things that war against the flesh, and also the spirit also war against the flesh. And they hold us captive. So whatever we want to do, we can't do them. And that is why the Apostle Paul stated that in Romans 7:19, he said, "The thing that I wanted to do, that is not what I do, but the things I don't want to do, I do them very easily." There is a con art in there that hook you. It's a stronghold. It's a stronghold. So we today, we want to talk about how to attack these strongholds. How to attack these strongholds. How a Christian will attack these strongholds, or how a Christian should attack the battle of life. How do Christians attack it? We attack it by the message that has been given to you and I. We attack it by the weapons we carry. Now, these weapons we carry are not weapons that are like materials physically that you can pick them up and then shoot somebody with a gun or try to knife them or do something. This is not that type of weapon that have been given to us. But this weapon is sharper than any two-edged sword. It is powerful than any other gun. It is stronger than everything. It is dynamite. The weapons that you cannot see with your eyes, except you come through God, except you understand your position. Without we identify ourselves to the task that God has given to us in the weapon, we will not be able to define who we are. And I would like to show you some few things that are triggering the situation that are going on in society. Hallelujah. So he said the human pride, that is the pride as independent from God. And this pride is called self-sufficiency. I'll do everything on myself. I don't need God. I am okay. I'm well educated. I got a good job. I don't need God. Self-sufficiency. And in our world we live, everywhere you pass is self, self, self. Self. Selfish. Now the second thing that we have to take them away, which are the two elements, the second one is the pride expressed through clever and plausible arguments or reasons that make the action based on pride sound like a logical thing to do. There is some lies that look very clear to you as if it is the truth. And we live our life in them. So they are around us. These are the two things. The pride, the self-independence away from God. And the other pride that lets you hear a voice, and the voice or what people are doing, you also follow it as if it is a very good thing. And everybody does it. I always complain to my wife that whenever I'm driving, and she's on my side, I said to her that before I started driving, my eyesight was very good. But with the process of years, with a driving career, my eyesight have changed. Though I know it's a part of growing, but I also understand that there have been an adaptation of life where at the new cars that are coming, they have put more light, very high light. And drivers have been told not to drive with that highlight in the street building areas where street lights are everywhere, but they put on the full highlight, the full beam. So every vehicle you meet on the road is the full beam that the light will flash in your eyes where you can't even have to open your eyes. And everybody is practicing, even police vehicles. You meet them and they are all doing the same thing. When one time I confronted one, I approached one of them. He said the vehicle has been adjusted to be that way. When the vehicle wants to mount up on the pump, the light come up of itself. And this light are LED. The LED are very powerful and strong. They get into the deep side of your eye. And this is affecting society. It's affecting people, but nobody can ever talk about that. Neither to try and take them out. We don't even mention it. We have adopted it and everybody is doing it. So people want a car, they're driving with a fog light and everything on. These are strongholds destroying the eyesight of people intentionally, and many are getting accidents where they have no idea how it happened. Before it flashed their eyes, they were blackout. So when we are speaking about certain things of the truth for people to understand, there will not be any fortune that will become a stronghold that hooks society. And this looks like it's a very real thing. So it's one of the pride expressed through clever and plausible arguments or reasonings that make the action based on pride sound like a logical thing to do. And everybody is doing it. I do it. Christians do it, everybody do it. Nobody even have talked about as I've seen. But I've for many occasions, and what even I thought police will come around, they will say, there's nothing you can do about it. They do it. They will try to quiet you, and you have to just take it and go your way. You can't fight against it. These are strongholds. So we live a life that are so difficult to challenge the situation that are going on around us. But it is very important for us to understand, as we seek to explain life in the light of scriptures, that they reveal that every heart of any social problem is always pride. This human sense of sufficiency without God. If people have God in their heart, if people have God in their mind, they will not do what they do. So there's something that hook them, that turns their mind away from God, that makes them feel they don't need God. They are all right to that. And some people have accepted themselves, they are Christians, but they also live their own life. We thought that God has given us a capability to do something, and we do that. But we don't do anything above God or beside God. We submit our will and He rule. But society is not operating that way. The world is not operating that way. It is operating in self-sufficiency. They are ungodly, taking God away and following a philosophy. They build their own argument, and even that for teaching our children in school. I have read up one of the books of which we call The History of Civilization. And if you go through this book, they speak about certain things, even at all Christianity, they talk about religion and other things. And the argument these books raise, you'll be shocked that it weakens your faith as a Christian. And so our children who go to school and finish university, they come up, they don't believe in God. The writings of the book have challenged, even when you talk about Christianity, they challenge the Bible which we carry from the Old Testament through the New Testament. They will challenge the book of Isaiah. They will make it look like it's just a history, it's nothing. They will challenge the book of Daniel according to the writing terms, and they will make it look like as if it's just only a history, but it's nothing. But these are existing in the schools of our children. It's existing in the university. And they will challenge the resurrection of Jesus Christ and say it was a lie. It's just the Bible is talking about. The Bible is just a book written by an individual. They don't want to know something supernatural. They don't want to know something of power. They don't want to know something of divine. It is all about a human being I've written, so I cannot accept it. I can make my own self like what other people have done. That is the pride, that is self-sufficient pride. The pride that makes everything look like it is good. So they build up plausible arguments, and all these things that are going on in our life and in the world around us, it is the work of Satan that have made it build that seem it is a very nice, plausible thing, logic to do. But it is false illusion. And that is the way we live our world. The world is built on false illusions, full of lies. But pride behind it have made it look like a logical thing. Hallelujah. So when we look at this thing, to solve these problems, whether they may be in their specific manifestation or not, it is what we have been given the powerful weapon to deal with them. Now how do this thing operate? There are sometimes these situations that our children and the problems which are going on in society, how they operate, is that you see that there are some people which are called the underdog mentality. These are people whose life are abandoned. They see themselves hopeless, nothing. And they want attention, so they will come up with something and make noise of it, and people hold it up and build a statement and argument, and then the pride behind it spread through the world. The underdog mentality. So you see our children go out there, they come up with a different thing. They grow up with a different thing. The way you raise them up, there is a force that is stronger than them. And it has affected the society around us. Now who will rescue the society? Except you and I, whom God is inside us, operating in us. walking through us, living among men, eating among men, talking among men, that we will allow him to use us to do what he wants to do to solve this social problem for us. So in defensive, we don't lay back and stay back, but we must be offensive in the Christian attack. And that is how we may attack it. And the power of the manifestation of this attack is seen through the gospel of Jesus Christ. As I said earlier, the gospel is the power of God unto salvation. The preaching of the cross. It is Jesus Christ and his crucifixion. That is the message you carry that will deliver you from all the troubles that are going on around you. All the problems and the apostles and the devils of society, either individually or socially. It is the message of the cross. And this is where we must see every script, every word, every situation, every problem in the light of this message that has been given to us. Other than that, we will not be free. The Bible says we shall know the truth, and the truth shall set us free. It is the truth about Jesus Christ and his crucifixion. The message of the cross. So this message is what we can deploy in every aspect. How will that be? How do we do it? The gospel is the proclamation of truth and the demonstration of love and righteousness and the operation of faith prayer. So when we preach the gospel is when we can see the weapon which are given to us. If you keep quiet without witnessing for Jesus, without talking about that, it means that the weapon is nothing to you. And you're not doing anybody, you are crippling yourself, because when you proclaim this message, it's that power that around or inside the message, the power began to demonstrate in your life. Many can preach it, many can shout about it, but they don't demonstrate it. If we are going to attack the world, we have to demonstrate the proclamation of the gospel, the preaching of the gospel, and the demonstration of which comes the truth, the love, the righteousness. So when we are proclaiming Jesus Christ and his crucifixion, it is the truth that God has given to us. That is the gospel. As 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 1-3 talk about, Christ died for our sin. And he was buried according to the scriptures. And he raised again on the third day. Now this is the message that has been given to you and I. That at the core of this message is where we find the weapons which have been given to us. It is this message that saved you and I from condemnation. That we were put to death spiritually. The message comes to save you from the grave. It comes to save you from captivity. It comes to set you free. It goes down to the bowels of the earth and went down and break the bowels of death and break the bowels of sin and break the bowels of Satan. Destroy them. Death could not hold him captive. That powerful weapon, that powerful message brought you out of the grave. So that you don't live your life awaiting to go to the gate of hell, or go to your name is not more written in the book of death anymore, but your name has been written in the book of life because of the power of this message, because of the gospel. He said, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have for eternal life. This eternal life that I've been giving to you is the message of the cross. When we hear about the cross, it sounds foolishness to the world. It will sound foolishness to them. But that is the weapon that defeats them. That is the weapon that destroys strongholds. That is the weapon that defeats every situation. The devils of our society. How do we attack? How do Christians attack? How do we attack? to attack. The gospel to attack. And except we proclaim it, except we can proclaim the gospel and understand and demonstrate it and operate in it, then we can pray to deliver people. Our prayers are not effective. Our faith is not strong enough. The Bible says many will depart from their faith and follow seducing spirits. This argument, this plausible lies, they are affecting many believers, and they're following from here and there, from pastors to pastors, church to church, everywhere they hear. Because why? They themselves are seeking to solve their fundamental problems, but they have not got any answer to it, and so they run about everywhere. They are confused. How can they save? How can they be offensive? They've forgotten. We've forgotten ourselves that the life that we live is not us. It is God who dwells inside us. We are just a temple of the Holy Spirit. Except we have not understood that we have offered our body as a living sacrifice unto Him, holy and acceptable, that He will use us. Except we have not understood that we have been transformed by the renewing of our mind. Except we have been told that we shouldn't be conformed to the things of the world. How? How do we do it? Now the Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians, the same place, no, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, chapter 2, verse 2. Now the Apostle Paul went to the city of Corinth, where this situation happened and where this letter, the passage we are looking through today, was happened, was written to. And when he went there, the people are facing the same situation. Sexual perversion, sexual license, racial division, family feud, political tyranny. All the problems that we know today were present in Corinth. But when he went there, this is how you can approach. And he have this has been there for example, for you and I, so that we can use to follow how we can deal with society. The situation and problem. So when he went there, he comes to this Greek city with this love of philosophy. The love philosophy as the world now, the world we live now, has fallen into philosophical values. They believe in revelation of the world more than the revelation of God. And so the revelation of the world have now dominant the power in the society we live. And the revelation of the world is the philosophy. And we have been given all the power to it. So in all everywhere, that is operating by science. So they bring the devil have bought that area and brought plausible lies, make it look like very nice. That, oh, don't forget about God and continue to live your life. You can create and do everything for yourself. The same situation that was in the Garden of Eden. Except you understand the saving grace in Christ Jesus, you have not been delivered from Garden of Eden. You are still under that bondage when we were subdued by Satan. So the Apostle Paul went to the city, and what he did with the situation, he went there without facing argument upon argument. We not into this world. We not been sent in this world to go in to deal with the problem with argument upon argument. He said, "For I determined to know nothing among you save Jesus Christ and Him crucified." I determined to know nothing among you save Jesus Christ and Him crucified. That is what you need. That is the message that you need. The message that can help you and I. So begin to speak about this message. Jesus Christ and His crucified is at the core of life. Life is defined, life is explained, life will be delivered in that message. If you want to tackle any problem in life and we miss that target, we will not be able to go anywhere. And if you look around the world, from all the age of history, civilization, and all what they've done, everything they have done without Christ, trying to deliver or set the problems of society free, all the struggles, have failed to today. They are trying to deal with situation, frustration, disappeared and is still growing up and all alone. And except we have come up to this, the truth, which is the power of God unto salvation, that have been given to you and I to deploy to this situation around us, that we can save ourselves and also set the captive free. That is what we have been given. That is where you were sent, to go into the world. But we sit and defend ourselves. We sit and lay back. So the church has become irrelevant. The church has become powerless. We can't touch life as it was supposed to be, because we have lost the power of the gospel. We have lost the understanding of the gospel. We have lost the power of the cross. That is the only message that can set us free. So the Apostle Paul, he declared that message. He was declaring the truth about life and about who? About God. The moment you preach the gospel, you are declaring the truth about life and God. The declaration of the truth of life and God means that you bring God involving into your life. We want God to live in our society. We want God to live in the midst of the problems which we are going through with us. We want God to live in the midst of where terrorism, everywhere you pass, political tyranny and all kinds of social problems. We want God to live in our middle, in our midst. And that's why the Bible says we live in the world. The world we live, unless we proclaim the gospel and bring God to live in our society and God dwell in us, but we have not blended ourselves with that power that has been given to us. So we walk as a miserable people without anything. But we the only source of people that have been given, a generation, a royal priesthood, that have been given us that power, the source to sort out the problems of society. So with that message, the Apostle Paul demonstrated the love of his heart and his willingness to deprive himself. That is one of the things. We haven't been able to think of depriving ourselves to save other people. So we are looking to save ourselves and we lay back. But this apostle went to the city with the same problem we are going through. He deployed, he declared the gospel, he preached the gospel. He didn't argue with them. He did not argue, counter argument. But he preached the message. He introduced to them that Jesus Christ died on the cross for them, according to their sins, according to the scriptures. And he was buried. So every trouble that they are going through, they shouldn't look at that change of that life, but they should look at it as a change of life. To know that all those things have been buried. I don't want to go through problems where I understand that I was in Christ Jesus when he was buried, and I was in him when he raised again. So the life I live, is not me. It is Christ who lives inside me. That is my legal position I stand. So when you tap my shoulders and say, Pastor Saul, it's not me. It is Christ who lives inside me. But I must demonstrate that it's not me, that old Saul anymore. I must demonstrate that it's Jesus Christ living inside me. So he loved people. The Bible said when he saw the multitude, he had the compassion to deliver them. Do I have that compassion in me? When he saw, now the Lord in you will see people, they see all the troubles, he see all the problems people are going through, and he will have compassion. And the compassion he has, what did he do? He now operate in faith prayer for them. The Apostle Paul began to pray for them. A prayer of faith. It is only a prayer of faith that can deliver this world we are living in. But except you preach the gospel, you declare the gospel of Jesus Christ, that is a sound foolishness to the people of the world, but that is the only source of power. That is the only area that the Bible declared that it is the power of God unto salvation. It didn't tell you that your world, anything is ever powerful, but the message of the cross. Christ died, and his body and his resurrection. That is the only time God opened his mouth and said it is powerful. It is only there we find righteousness. the only place we can bring the argument and all the proud that is going on in society. We can bring them low. It is when you kneel down on the cross, under the cross, then everything that are troubling you will not have any dominion over you anymore. Will not have any dominion over you. So the message of the cross is what we carry. Jesus Christ and him crucified stands at the very heart of life. Nothing can be understood properly apart from that. That is what the apostle means. With that message, he also demonstrated that. And so we must also demonstrate that. By demonstrating that, he also operated for them, operated in the gospel by praying for them. Because there is a law to the mercy. There is righteousness in it. There is a power. It is the only place you see God acting. God hasn't spoke to you anywhere apart from in his Son. If you want to know how God looks like, look at the Son. If you want to know the way God speaks, look at the Son. If you want to know how God walks, look at the Son. If you want to hear what God is telling you about your life, look at the Son. And the Son is the powerful rhema message that has been given to you and I. If you want to understand the fundamental question of your existence on this earth, he said, look at the Son. The Son is the only message that God is ready to talk to you about. If you want to know how God thinks about you, look at the Son. God doesn't see anybody outside the Son. God doesn't speak to anybody outside the Son. So he said, whosoever will, you have been given that powerful weapon. So we understand that Apostle Paul operated the same weapon and he worked in the city of Corinth. And there was a very powerful house of salvation established over there. That is the church of Corinth. A church was able to establish and become powerful. That is where this message or this passage was left us for our example. So we can look at the context of it and see to it that the same situation these people went through and the same message, the powerful weapon was employed or applied to their problems. And they were healed. These are people who live with philosophy. Corinth was one of the Greek cities. Greek was the philosophers. Plato, Aristotle, they were full of philosophers. They were the best philosophers in the world. And imagine, what message would not sound foolishness to them? So the apostle mentioned, I am not ashamed. Why? Because these people, whatever you take them, if you go to them with any argument, they will put you down. They have built a solid argument and pride behind it. So you can't come in them. They think that it is only that can rule the world, only that can save the world. But yet the problems of life were rampant, going on everywhere, destroying lives. No key answer to it. And the apostle said, it is only this. I didn't come to argue with you. I did not come to deploy with you with force. I did not come to use violence. I did not come to use demonstration as the world over do and burning houses and try to let everybody hear them. I didn't. I have come to introduce to you the message of truth where you will be set free. So the apostle preached the message, and this is how the message works. The message doesn't work in any other way. When you introduce this unworthy weapon to people, it makes them look like as if it is not better. It is nothing to them, but it sounds that it is true to them. Let me show you something, one of the things with human beings. Here is how we Christians must see the uniqueness of our position. It is when we understand this secret over here. Maybe you may not know, maybe you know, that this is how the gospel attacks people. It doesn't attack them face to face. The gospel message, if you use this message to counter-attack somebody with argument, they will put you down. It will not work. Because these plausible lies that look logic have been built over the years and long and strong defense. They are castles. Christians look at it. You cannot attack a castle on the strongest position. You cannot attack a castle on the stronger part. There is a weak, loose places of castle. It is behind the castle. The gospel attacks the strongholds and problems of the world behind it. Behind the castle. Behind it. How does it do it? How does it do it? Now the apostle says in two ways. He said he leads two steps over here. First, he destroys argument and every proud obstacle to the knowledge of God. Now, that is the only way we do it. How do we deploy or we destroy them? We're not going to talk about the capture of the thought, which we speak about that later. But there are many things to think about this passage over here and to enlighten you up so that you can be a powerful Christian in your generation. You are not going to die with failure. You are going to die with success. Leave your children just the one with a very successful name that God has blessed you on this earth. Regardless of any attack that you went through, I want to tell you that be sure of yourself that you carry a powerful weapon. Then don't let the crowd deceive you. Don't let the way the world look deceive you. Don't let the big philosophies, the intellectual mind of the world deceive you. Don't let the big science and technological advancement deceive you. The power of the traditional weapon you carry is from heaven. It is powerful. It is dynamite. It is the Alpha. It is the Omega. It is the who I am that I am. He is everything. Mighty God. He created the world. And there is something in it. Now when you look through your Bible to the book of Ecclesiastes chapter 3, he spoke about something. That's why I want to show you that is the area the gospel can hit. The gospel doesn't hit argument upon argument. It doesn't hit power upon power. That is not the way it does. If you, the Apostle Paul have come to argue, counter argument from them, he will fail. Because they have built a solid, strong argument. The devil understands that. He has seen everywhere, every gate. But there is a secret hole. There is a secret loophole. There is a secret of the strongholds of the world. And that secret, unless that secret is revealed, unless you find that secret, unless you understand that secret, you will think that your weapon is not working. But your weapon works effectively, but you don't know how to apply it. How to apply it? How to apply it? Now when you look at this thing, you understand that it doesn't go with a counter-attack. No! No, no, there is a secret in man. The secret in man. Every human being that are living on this world are living in a dimension. Listen to me very carefully, please. Because this is the only time you can hear this message. Listen to it very, very carefully. Every human being on this earth is living with one dimension. What I'm trying to tell you is that the length of life of everybody is determined upon the day you were born, you live through life, and then to the day you die. That is a dimension. That is what the devil knows. So he has built all the strongholds and everything. He sees every day. So if you want to look for a loophole to persuade mankind or people through that dimension, then you will fail. Every human being is living in one dimension. And in that dimension, if by where means they want to improve it, they cannot go beyond any other level except only maybe two dimensions. It's like the length of a thing and the breath. That is the level they can go. The length and breath. That is the dimension that everyone goes. And that is also the dimension the devil also know and have built every argument and proud obstacles around that. So he has seen as a big, strong tower. He has built a big, strong castle around it. The argument is so solid that you cannot win them. The devil is behind that. They have written their own that for the gospel. But here comes the secret. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, the verse number 11 talk about something over here. He said, God has made everything beautiful in its time. Hey, and what did he do? He has put eternity in your heart. In whose heart? You, your heart. He has put eternity. Do you see how the Father has got a secret where the devil don't know? There is another dimension that God has put in you that nobody knows. Do you ever know that those people who are committing sin, they have some secret of another world which is eternity in them? Everybody carries that, but they don't know. If they would have known, they would have built their argument on that as well, but they have no idea about it. And even if they know, they can't do anything about it. Another dimension. The Bible says he put what? Eternity in your heart. Except that no one can find out the work that God does from beginning to end. So we, to understand that world, except you come in front of God and be like a baby. And for you to come to God, you can't come to God. So you need to come to the cross. So Jesus said, let these children come unto me. Everybody who wants to come to the kingdom, you must be like a child, a baby. Why? A baby doesn't know anything. You come down as nothing. Except you have been born like that child, you will not be entered the kingdom of God. It is the child. Everybody needs to be born again. Born like a child who don't know anything. So I see born again believers who talk too much. I doubt about them. A child who has been born doesn't know anything. They begin to learn things by way of their parents, teaching them and feeding them and growing them. The same way, believers must begin to learn something. We must begin to understand how life has been built for us, that we have been born anew. And that is the only way we can be able to understand another world that God has placed in the heart of you. If not, that secret you will never know. So all the secret that is hidden all these people, before they can know, unless they become like a child born new under the cross. The only way that child can be born is under the cross, believing of that filthy blood message, that foolish message to the world. That is the only way you can be born, that new child. It is the only way that another world that is hidden inside the place in your heart will be revealed to you. When you become a born again, you never know before you become a born again. You never know that there is another life for you. You thought that life is too short. The day you were born, the day you die. The day you were born, you grow and die. So the Bible has spoken about it. There is a time for everything. But God has made beautiful, everything beautiful in his time. But there's something behind in your heart. But that's something, except you being born like a baby, a child. Under the cross, the filthy cross, and the world hates it. The philosopher of the world can never take it. The revelation of the world cannot understand it. It sounds foolishness to them. God made it that way so that they will not understand. Seeing, they will see, but they are blind. Hearing, they will hear, but they are deaf. Except you be born like a child, you will not be able to understand another dimension. So there is a vacuum inside you. Vacuum in everybody. Vacuum in the people who are sinning. Those who are doing bad, naughty things. Those who have been captured by the devil. So the devil has been watching them, take them and deceive them so that they will disobey the gospel who can save them. They will disobey the gospel who can give them eternal life. They will disobey what God has given to them, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish. The devil has deceived them. He has made it look like it's a plausible life, but he makes it look like logic. that when you don't believe that, you are okay with that. So with pride, people don't want to bow down on the cross. If you haven't bowed down on this cross, except you bow down on the cross and be born again, your pride will never go away. And many believers carry pride. They don't even have it, they don't know. They carry pride, self-sufficiency, but they call themselves the Christians. Check yourself. Check yourself. Anger and pride are ruling believers. All these characteristics of satanic events to plausible lies look like it is okay with them. Except you bring them under the cross. It is under the cross that we negotiate the terms of life. Either your position, your standard of life, or the position you stand. You stand in two oppositions. Either you go to hell or you go to heaven, it is based on the cross. So the Apostle Paul said, I didn't come to argue with you, I have come to you with this message. That is what I have come to you for. The message of Christ and Him crucified. That is the message I have for you. That is the message I have for you. The reason why I saw take a time is that you needed this message to enlighten your brain, to kill out all kinds of blockages in your brain, for you to understand the proper tool of the gospel. Many have lived in the social gospel for many years, and people have been mixing the teachings of the scriptures, teachings of the Bible, and make it look like it is the gospel. But they don't declare, they don't sound good as the gospel. They don't sound to deliver people, and still people carry their problem. There are many in the church who have been delivered, but their problems come back. Many in the church who have been set free, but their problems come back. Why? Because the truth were not taught. The demonstration of the truth were not seen. The oppression of the truth were not seen. Why? They have not the truth about the gospel. They have not bowed down for the truth. They have not been born anew as the newborn child who qualifies to understand the depth. And once you haven't understand that dimension, you are in trouble. It is only when we become to know God, born as a new child, that we, our eyes, the veil of our eyes open, that we have, God has made us to live three dimensions. I don't know if you know that. I live in three dimensions. Three different worlds. The day I was born, my physical life, I'm living up to the day I will die, and that is the death where the Bible teaches me to number my days. That my heart will every time have wisdom. And by exploration of education and all kinds of experience and everything, I add up a breath. But many people have not known. There is another dimension of my life which is called the depth. The depth of me. The deep of me. The deep inside of me. If you look through your Bible, you see that the Bible said that in Psalm 42 verse 7, it said, deep, call that deep. That deep is where you have with God. That deep is where every human being longs to suffer. People cry. Do you know how people are frustrated about that area of their life? The deep of you, it is only Christianity that builds that deep of you. And because people have not seen the deep of them, that is why many troubles and problems and sin and bad things are going on in our society. Why? Because they are so long to suffer. They so cry for the deep part of them that is missing. So they cry, where is the life that was lost? Where is the life? If they build it on their own self or their own righteousness, it takes them to arrogance and it takes them to death. They die. We die. Our righteousness, self-righteousness doesn't take us anywhere. We die. So there is something missing in the heart of you. And that is the third dimension of you. And that third dimension, except you be born new as a newborn child, as the Lord Jesus spoke about it, then you can now qualify to see that dimension of you. And you grow spiritually with that dimension. And that is where you can see joy, happiness. Ha. That is the only place you can see there is some different atmosphere. Either problem or no problem, either money give. Any other thing, nothing can separate you. It's just only the joy of the Lord that becomes your strength. So the word of the Lord, we must teach them that they must be born, they must bow down, they must be born like a newborn baby before they will see. Because they are so long suffering, they cry. And so many, because of that kind of that dimension who they are missing, they now bring a lot of trouble. They want attention. They come in, they do kill people, and they go back to prison because something inside them are crying. Something inside so strong. That is what is crying, yelling in the heart of people, but they don't know the vacuum inside you, another dimension. But so because of that, many people build, they try to explore things, they look for everything, they want to build that dimension themselves. The philosophers, the scientists, they try everything, but yet they cannot replace that dimension. The more they try, they just only extended that old rhythm of that dimension they have already. But the devil has built up the strong pillars around it. So the more they try to find the missing world they're looking for is what Christianity can give, what the gospel and law can give. There's no other way that you can see that missing world. That missing world is given to us back by the message of the cross. And the world doesn't know. So we have to attack by that, by the gospel. When we attack the gospel, that the gospel now touch the vacuum. The gospel doesn't come and argue with me. No. The gospel hit the vacuum. For example, as I'm talking to you now, some of you are feeling inside you, your body is shaking inside you. You feel that that is the vacuum of you. The area that make you feel, oh, I'm a sinner. The area that make you repent. The area that make you feel that you need God over there. The area that make you fear. So when you preach the gospel to the world, it sounds foolishness to them, but when it hits the vacuum of them, they go, they cry inside them. They can't go. If you have realized that, I was taught, I was a very stubborn person. I was a very blind. I don't even respect pastors. But when the message of the cross touched me, I became very weak. I was driving alone to come back. I was bathing to come back. I was sleeping to come back. I came to realize that I have something that is called my soul. That I began to ask some questions. This is how the world, when the message of the gospel is preached, this is how we attack it. We attack the problems of society. The problem is bad because of wrong and wounded ego. They're looking for the crying, the yearning of this dimension they don't have. Only we Christians have that dimension, and above all, only proper Christians. There are some Christians, they don't even have it. They don't have the death. These quality, they don't have it. And you see them about your body. This is, if you want to see that, if you see somebody struggling to go through all people, go around people, struggling to associate with people, they don't have the deep, the depth. I want to show you this thing because I'm not hiding anything from anybody. They don't have the depth. You need to go deep with God and you see that you will be released. If you see someone living with fear and anxiety, they don't have the depth. If you see somebody chasing the things of the world, they don't understand the things of the spirit, they don't have the depth. The depth. D-E-P-T-H. Depth. Learn depth. Depth. This area, the deep. The deep, the riches. The riches of you. The one that explores your glory. That area is only God carrying the key. The devil doesn't know. When that area is touched, you will never feel any left out. You never feel any better. You'll be able to stand very strong. And that is the area where the gospel touched. The gospel touched the vacuum of man. Man's heart. There's area where the Bible says that God has placed eternity in your heart. Either you are a sinner or whatever you are, He has placed that over there. So the moment a sinner is being transformed and repent, he got eternal life. He now finds it. When you find it, the veil now open. Then you began to explore that new world, the Christian world, the eternal life, the new heaven, the new Jerusalem. And that is where you live with your life as faith. So when you pray, you now have a connection to your prayer. When you walk boldly because you have a power that look after you. You got a network. That network is like you carry your mobile phone. If you haven't registered your mobile phone, you call it. My daughter will have one that you play with it. You can even talk with it, but nothing comes out. But when you now register to the software or network provider, you can now walk everywhere and call. That connect. That is the new world, the new adventure. By carrying the mobile phone, you can be able to connect to that world of mobile. The same way, we in the third dimension that makes you a born-again believer, that dimension, only when you become a born-again believer, that's how you can understand that dimension. Then it connects you to the family of that. But except you be born like a baby, little born child, and you begin there, that little born child, except you are born of what? God would be in the last place I leave you with a Bible to the book of John chapter 3. John chapter 3. John chapter 3. John chapter 3. Hallelujah. We will continue again because these are messages that you need to know all the details of it. Don't walk about them because they will transform you. Nobody can pull you up. Mighty God. Now verse 5 says, most assuredly I say unto you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Jesus is talking about this. Is a big teacher who have come to see the Lord. And this man, the third dimension, is crying. His heart is crying for it. And when Jesus preached, he that message to him, he now began to take his eyes open. He asked one question: how can I go to my mother's womb to be born again? He said, that's not what I'm telling you. Even you, as a teacher of the law, you don't understand this. So the world of philosophy don't understand the gospel. Because what the gospel does you, the world cannot offer. So Satan has defended every area to stop you obeying, to stop you believing, so that he can hold you as his own property. And you lost. Satan has lost that world. He didn't get opportunity for it. He lost it because of what? Pride. He built argument and pride behind the argument to come against God. And he was thrown from heaven, from his position. Now, because of that wounded ego in Satan, he has come to deceive you as well, so that you will listen and make it pride as if it looked nice. So you go to hell with him. That's how many people do bad things. Because they are wounded. They want a lot of people to come with them. They cannot go live alone without having a lot of things. So many have come and deceive people and open up a church or something and go and kill a lot of people in some places. Many kinds of religious activities, relatively have been open, deceiving people to follow them, to build up their own dogmatic rule to let people follow them. These are satanic lies, plausible lies. They will come, the next time you see them, they say, I'm a pastor. I can tell you, still, there are people following them because they want to hear. Your ears are telling you. How can you fight the battle of life when you have a weakness in you? The devil doesn't give a chance to any weakness of you. He consumes those areas quickly. Except a man be born again. That is the only way you can find the other dimension that God God has placed in your heart. And it is in your heart. It is in your heart. If you haven't found him, look to be born again. Then you will find the 10 dimension in your heart. We will continue next week and to continue to explore until the young men and women, yes, will be able to talk about it. I will speak about this thing until it comes from Joseph and Jocelyn and Ruth and Shekinah Glory and Ebenezer. It comes through their mouth and they will be talking about it. Because these are messages you need. When you grow with them, no one can deceive you. No heresy. The whole world is deceived by heresy. That is why it is like the way it is. But you are not following that. Your life is different. God of God to set you free. And I speak that freedom to you right now. I speak that freedom to you right now. Whatever has set you apart, your life apart and deceived you for all the years, I break it in the name of Jesus. Because the truth has come to set you free. And today you are free indeed in the name of Jesus. But as you, every situation that is going on in our society, it can never touch you. Because what? You are in Christ Jesus. That power of God unto salvation has been placed inside you. And as you have eaten it, nothing shall always hurt you. The Bible said, what can separate you from the love of Christ? Is it death? Is it height? Is it peril? Is it poverty? Is it what? Is it curses? What can separate you? There is the third dimension which you have been hooked, sealed in the battle of Christ for that. And nothing can take you away from that place. The assurance of your salvation, your eternal security, it depends on the message of the cross that sounds foolishness to the world. But today, if anybody who is listening to me, if you have been ruled by pride, you have been ruled by argument, and you build on your own way, you think that it is very nice for you. That pride, kneel down on the cross and say, Lord Jesus, I have come to surrender everything. I can't do anything of myself. Lord, I want you to save me. And you will see the third dimension. What your heart has been yearning for many years will be open to you just like that. And you see a new world, a new world of understanding, a new world of advancement, a new world of love. You will see the love of God being shed abroad in your heart. And you will begin to see how you love your wife, how you love your husband, how you love your children, how you love people. People call about love, but they've never seen love before. Except you be born as a newborn baby, you will never enter the kingdom of God. But that is born of the Spirit. It's of the Spirit. May your life be restored. May your spirit grow up. May you be imparted with this knowledge and you can fight your world. All the troubles that are going on in the world shall never defeat you. Because the gate of hell cannot prevail against you as a child of God. You are a stone built on the rock that nothing shall always hurt you. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for this special time and the moment which you have given to us, Lord. We have spent the time in front of you, Lord. Father, as your children that are sat under the sound of my voice, mighty God, I stand as a mediator and lead them unto you, mighty God. Dedicate all of them unto you that they spend their time sitting under here for that length of time to listen to your message, mighty God. They need something. Father, touch them and open their mind. Even what they don't know, Lord, bring to them. You them, Lord. I want them as you want them to go and touch life. Speak unto the people. Preach the gospel. Touch souls. Touch life, mighty God. Build them up that they will be able to know themselves. They will know their position. That they will have authority about every situation that they are going through. Anything that want to cripple them, today they have authority about them by the power of the Holy Spirit in the name of Jesus. Receive grace, receive grace, receive grace, receive grace. Let the power of God bend around you right now, wherever you are. As you go home with that power in your homes. Everywhere you go, that power will follow you. Them that hate you can never come around you. Every stronghold in your life, that power, that fire, burn it. That fire, burn it. The Bible said, they that dwell in the secret place of the Most High. You dwell in the secret place of the Most High. So the third dimension of your life is that you have the love of God in your heart. And nothing can touch you. That love, follow, flow, 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 flow in every part of your life, in your relationship, in your finances, in your love with God, in your appetite of the word of God, every part of your life, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And the people of God say,